Thank you. Head other way. Take your camera. Get your arm out. Turn your head. Turn your head. Relax.
Get out. Good job. Pardon.
Hey.
Hey, partner. Thank you.
out for that. I've only been in three times so far.
Yes.
That's already business.
Go with it.
That was also resistance. Thanks, Herman. That's it. It's not an exceptional. The edema is still pumping. That's it. You gotta find your chemi. Not an external thing. You're not making the arm softer stay. Internally, the arm is soft. So, yin and yang are relative terms. Nothing in itself is innately one or the other. It's always relative to something else. So, it's not that he is going that way, and therefore my yin move has to go that way. He is yin, right? And inside, I am now more relaxed than him. And he is gone, inside I'm more relaxed than him. So that technique is here, just more relaxed. Then my yin can actually go inside your yang. Can you understand this? He's pushing, and as long as I'm more relaxed than him, I'm yin to him. Do you get it? So I don't have to have a big yin pattern. You see? Just inside to him, I feel him, boom. And I say yin to him. Yin to him. Yin. Yin to him.
in the head. Yin did it. Get it? So, when I asked you that last time, you all went externally. Okay, correct it. Good, and enter just the same. Catching you off guard. Better. You gotta go. It's still G you want. Too much tension, she can't come in that way. That's not sumiatosh. You don't use that grip. That's the sumiatosh you came in with. You don't use that grip. It's anatomically inferior. Palm faces away. Fingers up. That's it. Rear arch up, back foot engaged. Kick him in the face. Don't overthink it. If you stay relaxed, you'll stay in and connected. Make sure you're not in your PJs ready for bed. Okay? The arm is yin to her, but the center is engaged. Me, it's not yin to her. Do you understand? Okay. So don't go entering with a cloud, a nice fluffy white cloud. You enter with a thunderbolt. Go. Not into him. Okay. Yeah, and pull heads down.
Thank you very much.
Any questions, comments? Observation? Yes.
I found it very difficult to then start thinking about the metaphor you were giving me and start thinking about it, and then I lost everything I had, and even the little bits that I might have had, I just lost. It's as if I'm too busy processing words and not actually feeling what's going on.
It's very likely. There's not enough reps, so that art is still intellectually based. So I'm reading this book, The Talent Curve, and I mentioned another study at Cambridge City. It's very suspicious. I didn't get to that study yet. I'm going to read it. It's just very suspicious that it ends up with 10,000 in 10 years. 10,000 reps in 10 years. And 50. Is it because those are the Budo traditional values? It said 10 years. It takes 10 years. It's just weird that the number 10,000. Like, how many reps have you done so far? Who counts their reps? You know what I mean? So I don't know how they did this study. Did they study someone for 10 years? Like, what is the funding for that? You know what I mean? These are the traditional values, and the number 10,000 in East Asia is infinity. Which makes sense, because at the same time in the talent code they talk about it being a perishable skill. So then what the fuck is with 10,000 if it's a Western understanding of that value? So it's probably they went to the martial artists and they asked them, and the dude answered them with the traditional value. It was 10 years, 10,000. And then they don't have a cultural context to go, wait a minute. 10,000 in your guys' speak is infinity, and they just pass it on. So I say just keep it infinity, right? There's some value, but we don't know where it is, where the technique, the art, it stops being an intellectual process, and it's in your body. And even at that point, if you neglect to continue your training, it comes out of your body and goes back into your intellectual processing. Okay. So, I mean, every time that I do something and it's not at the level of my body, I do more of it. I don't just go, well, you know. Because I know the process, so I just start working the process. More reps. More reps. I don't ever go, well, I did enough. I go, I have not done enough. Whatever my value is, it's not enough. Because it's not in my body. It's in my intellect, I guess. And things in my intellect are things that are not truly mine. And when you get into something like Jiwaza, you guys are deciding what to do, and I am feeling what to do. And feeling is a much more quickly determined decision-making process, because the gap between what you do and what you're feeling is not present. You push it on me, and so I don't decide to yield. I feel you pushing on me. You see? You guys have to go, wait. Oh yeah. And then it's done. You know what I mean? It's just like in the Nebwas, I have no idea what I'm going to do. I have no idea. All I know is I'm going to release my egoic, fear-motivated resistance. And then you end up where I need you to be, without needing it. So I would say for your sake, I wish you would keep your center and you could get projected out of the technique safely. But for my sake, hey, I don't mind. I'll stomp on your neck, kneel on your face, do the kimura on you while I sit on your head. I don't care. It doesn't feel wrong to me because I just stayed in a relationship of sensation, of feeling with you. You get it? This is why there's no gap. You just land right in the damn thing. So more reps. I think like the biggest contributor to progress is reps. I put reps even above mindset. Because while it is possible you can just go through the motion, it gets more difficult to do the more reps you do. If you can add mindset to reps, you're golden. But if you can't add reps to mindset, it doesn't matter. You're never going to get it. So you should prioritize your rep count. That'll get you in the ballpark much more efficiently and surely than mindset. Anything else? You keep pushing on the people. You're yang to their yang, but you weigh nothing. So it doesn't work. Right? Also on you, you had a lot of broken center. And the center is getting broken because you're not ready for the fall because you have a preference for fall. And then this isn't what you were thinking or wanting, and now you get surprised. And then the fear comes in, and then the fear goes as an egocentric orientation, and now you can't maintain your body organization. The center disengages, poof, because you're no longer pressing on the nage. You're like, oh, really? And it all disengages, everything disengages. There's no expansion to your body mind. It just goes in. And then you're just falling, and you're caught off guard so much that your head's the wrong way, over and over, your arms are trapped under you, right? You're just not ready. You're ready for mercy, for it to stop and to be allowed to do what you were wanting to do. And that's not uke. Use the ukemi experience. It's not 50% of not training time. It is training time. It is the better training time, to tell you the truth. Because like for me, as I was going, that's most of my ukes were doing that. They like came in way more than they wanted to, and now they start resisting the technique. And it basically, I was just stomping and kneeling on and kimuraing people underneath me constantly. So I go, well, just focus on ukemi. Because you, as I come to grab you, you're tense as shit. And because I'm human, it will trigger me, you see? Because I feel your tension, and then I will relax. So now I'm practicing the very mechanism of Aiki, but from ukesa. So don't practice the fear cycle as uke. It's not really 50% wasted of training time. It's using 50% of your training time to reify the fear cycle. Anything else? Did you have something?
I just want to switch off that I couldn't feel when I was countering. Or I was trying to find that center and beginning to feel in body conditioning, but then just totally lose it.
Well, you're stomping like all over the place. So if you're walking forward and then you're stomping, then you're trying not to walk forward, you see. It's not that you can't feel it, it's that in the midst of the fear cycle, you lose consciousness. You lose awareness. You can't tell what you're doing, which is why you can't tell what I'm doing, which is now it triggers you even more because the fear of the unknown kicks in, and now you just go, this please. Road training. Or you could also know how tired you get because it's triggering you, you see? And in the fear cycle, we prematurely exhaust and you get really tired. And see the difference in as I'm moving and being uke, it's very relaxed compared to where you guys are. Okay? So you can use our exhaustion levels to tell us, am I relaxing or am I being triggered repeatedly? Basically, you're going from adrenaline dump to adrenaline dump. Do you see that? Any places you got stuck a lot? So there might be nothing wrong with one move if the uke keeps giving you the energy from the one. Trying to do multiple moves is as wrong as trying to do one move. If the energy print is one move, then that's fine. I'm not attached to it. Or I don't avoid it either. Sometimes in our attachment to not do the same move, then we're just practicing preference and rejection. I don't have a problem with the same things.
I would get stuck when I'm just wanting to go in up to my yang, and then you'd just be standing there and there was no feed, and I then have to force someone. It wasn't like a feed would happen.
Yeah. And a lot I saw is that you're just grabbing heads like it's so easy. Come on. You can't milk the drill, right? We are trying to do a physio-psychological releasing. That is the part of the drill, the heart of the drill. But we don't want to milk it where now I don't even have the art. So I just grab heads because I don't want to lower the hand because that makes me have to bend my knees and that's too much work. On the podcast I recommended today, it was a great point, a fantastic point. It's true, this is spontaneity, but I've always said it's not any spontaneity. You can't just come out here with a clarinet and start jamming some spontaneous jazz, you know, or we start jiwaza and you get your basketball out and you start, right? So the teacher was talking about mindfulness, right? You know, it's mindfulness. And even a torturer can practice mindfulness. So there's an added component to the releasing that we're doing. And it is a matter of harmonizing yin and yang. It is a matter of releasing for the sake of aiki, for the sake of decontesting.